everyone, and welcome to Vaffa Tragics, the final episode of season 2015. We hope you've enjoyed the show over the course of the year. We've got a final 20 minutes or so to get through as we review some of the grand finals from the weekend and look ahead to the Premier Section grand finals to take place on the week ahead. Before we do that, though, let's welcome the panel. As always, on the left-hand side, we've got Marty Kelleher, in the middle, William Balm, and to the right of him, Brenton Mann. Good evening, guys.
Good evening, Andrew. How are you?
Very well, thanks, Brenton. Marty, how are you?
I'm well. Well, indeed, Andrew.
And Will, how are you?
He's giving us nothing, Will. Just a lot. Just as usual. Yeah, just giving us nothing. Yeah.
Disappointing. It's good to see he's got a good jacket on, though. So, well done there, Will. We will start things off, though, by commencing with good day, bad day. Because you had a bad day. Marty, kick us off with your final good day, bad day for 2015.
Thanks, Andrew. As I've been saying each week, a good day for me was Corfe Grammarians under 19s. Terrific outcome, really, really good result for the fields, particularly given the travails that their seniors have gone through this year. So it's a really good outcome for them. And my bad day, and I don't really like saying this because they were my tip at the start of the year for the Prem C flag, is Marcelin. That's seven finals in a row they've lost.
Brenton, who had a good day and a bad day on the weekend?
Good day for me were the blokes that reside north of the city, our old Paradians, out at Garvey Oval. They had a gritty...
Now, this isn't a butter-up, is it, to some of the response you had?
No. Copped a bit of flak on Sunday morning from the boys from Old Parade and have been reined in today as well. So that's been very nice. But you've got to cop that when you're in the media, Andrew. But yeah, Old Parade with a 15-point win over Ivanhoe, who will be distraught after being the form side all year. And thanks to the boys from Parade, from your just your comments throughout the year. It's nice to hear from them after they win the grand final. You just don't hear from them during the year either. It's nice.
Nothing wrong with a bit of humility and victory?
No, humility and victory. Celebrate your wins. Don't worry about the scribe. My opinion doesn't count. Just worry about your own backyard.
Right, yeah. And the bad day?
St. Bees, Mentone Tigers. 43 points up. Probably had an eye on to the next week. Yeah, and then Old Maburnians ran over the top of them and ended up smashing them in the end. 5 goals to 16 after quarter time is a drubbing.
Well, perhaps we'll start there with the Premier B preliminary final. Disappointing result for St. Bede's Mentone Tigers after they went so close to St. Kevin's a week prior, and OM's just, they came to play in the second half.
From hearing what I'm from St. Bede's Mentone Tigers, I think they were just mentally drained from their semi-final loss. They pushed Scobs all the way and didn't get the result, and they were positive about their performance, but they thought they could get Scobs if they faced them again, but OM's just caught them off guard and just ran over the top of them.
Well, it's actually going to ask that question. Was it a case that there was almost a mental fatigue?
Yeah.
That not just the physical effort, but it was more the mental effort to get so close to to what was a fairly dominant, which is a dominant St. Kevin side.
Yeah, it certainly is. And yeah, from all reports, they were out on their feet in the second half, OM just ran over the top of them.
I did forget my good days and bad days, yes, so perhaps I better get them out of the way first. So, good days, a number of people could have had good days. Anyone from St. Bernard's responding in the prelim. OM's, of course, got up. Q's 3 premierships in a row, we mentioned. You mentioned Old Parade. I liked West Brunswick, though. Back-to-back premiers in Division 3, winning by a point, the skinniest of margins. And congratulations to Canterbury as well, who won their first VAFA flag. Bad days, Emmaus St. Leo's. Now, they went undefeated throughout the season, and to lose on grand final day after missing out on playing the grand final the year before, losing by a point in the prelim, they set themselves for it, they got there, and West Brunswick got them. 2 years in a row, West Brunswick have beaten the undefeated side in the grand final.
And by a very skinny margin, which would hurt even more.
It's a bit rough getting a bad day, but I think when you've been undefeated for the year, it's a tough blow.
They have been quite dominant throughout the year. They haven't just been getting over the line, they've been smashing sides, and they smashed Aquinas and in the semi-final. They would have fancied their chances and just the better team.
West Brunswick, though, it's very similar build-up to how they won the premiership the previous year against Hawthorne. Hawthorne had taken all before them the previous year. West Brunswick, I think, in about round 16, got to within about 16 points. They went down to Hawthorne by. In round 17 this year, they lost by 7 points to Emmaus St. Leo's. And have a feeling in the group, we're close to these guys. We're not far off them.
We just need one more chance. Yeah. Yep. Which is probably the St. Bede's thing. In that they probably felt really quite confident, but just weren't able to get the momentum going or maintain the rage, shall we say, in Prem B.
On to the Prem B grand final ahead. St. Kevin's chasing a first flag since 2004 when they last won in Premier B. OM's also a Premier B premiership winner in 2009. So a short time between drinks for both of these clubs. Who do you fancy in the decider on Saturday here at Sports Cover Arena?
I don't think you can go past St Kevin's. I don't think OM's will put up a decent fight, but I think it will just be their class will just shine through.
I think so. I think that it probably was quite a nervous performance in the second semi. I think they've got that monkey's off the back. They are promoted. They've nothing to lose. So I think that we'll see a full expression of the way that the boys from St Kevin's can play, because they really do deserve to go through and win it, because they have been the dominant team all year.
Yeah.
Chasing champions team status, of course, as well as St Kevin's. I don't think we've had a champion team for a number of years in the BAFA at senior level.
No, not at senior level, but John Edgar, who's the co-coach at St Kevin's Old Boys, he was under-19 coach at De La Salle in 2010 when they went through as premiers and champions. So it'll be a unique double for him if they were able to do that.
Certainly would be indeed. I'm sure that both Edgar and Harford would be in line for Coach of the Year honours, which I think Edgar got with the under-19
yes,
in that premiership year with De La Salle, yep, for the junior Coach of the Year. Into Premier Section, the preliminary final was on Sunday. It was here at Sports Cover Arena. There were question marks over St Bernard's kicking for goal leading into the game. They kicked 5 goals, 18 in their semi-final loss to Old Trinity. They reversed that to kick 18 goals, 5 at Sports Cover Arena, and comprehensively beat University Blues in the end.
What a difference a week makes.
Yeah, yep, that's right.
And yet the conditions were... obviously it was a much better day. It was a lovely day on Sunday. However, the game would have been affected by wind as it was the previous week. So where's the logic? And so sometimes in the game, there is no logic, is there?
We discussed off air that the Blues put Watts behind the ball in the first quarter. Was that they played him a bit out of position?
Yes, if we think about the previous week, I mean, Blues started with the breeze, well, with the typhoon that pushes down to the golf course end.
It does.
The previous week, Jack Watts had played all 4 quarters at the scoreboard end of the ground. On Sunday, he didn't start there. Who knows? But the fact is that he had such a great game the previous week. It's the old adage, is it? You know, if it's not broken, don't fix it.
I would have thought you'd roll with the same tactics again.
Yeah, I would.
Well, it's pretty simple, isn't it?
I agree. I think coaches sometimes try and be a bit radical in finals and try and change things up a bit, but I think you go with the tried and true, go with what got you there, and unfortunately for Jack, he also got a red card on the day, which was not a good day.
No, a couple of reports out of that game as well. Pete Summers as well, I think, got reported as well.
Yeah, in the first quarter, yeah.
Yeah. Which I guess put Uni Blues behind the eight ball, having numbers down for those periods of the game as well. I think Watts also, congratulations on a great career in the VFA. He's now living in Sydney. I think that was his last game officially for Uni Blues. So
not a great way to go out, though,
no,
is it? I mean, obviously the loss would have been painful, but for Jack, who is a multiple state rep, is a much revered player within the VAFA, but also within Uni Blues, to go out on a sour note like that is probably not a great way for him to walk.
They'll still be thereabouts next year, Blues, though. They've got a number of young players. If they're all hanging around and they're all still going to uni at the colleges around Melbourne Uni, they'll be a formidable side next year in William Buck Premier Section, Will Uni Blues. The grand final will take place at Princess Park or Icon Park on Sunday, of course, and it will be Old Trinity in their first ever Premier Section Grand Final up against St Bernard's, whose last flag was it in Premier Section or A grade as it was back in 2002. Old Trinity chasing a first premiership since 1999 when they won Premier B. Who do we like in this game and why?
I think St Bernard's. I think it was their inaccuracy in front of goal that cost them in the semi-final against Old Trinity, and Old Trinity just ran over the top of them. But I think St Bernard's have the game to get over Old Trinity, and it's going to be a massive test of Old Trinity's resolve. They've shown it all year. They're going to have to show it on the last day.
I haven't sat in the fence all year. I suppose I really shouldn't do it now. I think this is a nightmare, because I think that the three games that they've played have all been decided by under 10 points. I have a horrible feeling. I don't think this one will be. I think that...
You think it's going to be a blowout?
I just think that St Bernard's are coming back from last year where they had a very disappointing finals campaign. I think they've got a lot to prove. I think that they might get over them.
I have a feeling it might be St Bernard's as well, but I'm going to stick to my guns and go with Trinity to win a first ever Premier Section Premiership. I reckon if Trinity do win it, there could be a release because most of their list are about the 2021-year-old mark. They could arguably be featuring in the next 5 or 6 years of
they could have a dominant era.
Oh, I think they'll still be fit. I mean, there's no doubt. One way or the other, they'll still be there or thereabouts in the next few years because they are very well coached and they're obviously a very coachable group and they've got good numbers coming
they're
through.
They're so young as well.
Yeah, absolutely.
They're so young. All their good players are 20, 21, 22.
Yes.
And it's an unbelievable position they're in, Old Trinity, and good luck to them both and both sides, and we hope to get a big crowd at Icon Park.
Yes.
I should have mentioned at Sports Cover Arena on Saturday, if you weren't aware, the VAFA sponsor Bayford is giving away a Volkswagen Golf. There will be three clubs kicking to win the Golf, with the kicks going the way of Ajax, Piran, Assumption and Canterbury, with a view to if you can land a kick from 50 metres in the back of a Volkswagen Amarok, your club will take home a Volkswagen Golf on the day.
Does it have to stay in the boot or can it just go in and if it bounces out?
It has to bounce in and stay in the boot. It is possible. I'm not sure if Piran Assumption are recruiting Billy Brownless or Shane Crawford. Any one of those people that have run through Piran Assumption, but I think it does have to be a listed player. So I understand Ajax have been practicing for a couple of months because they've been in the top three of cars sold via the club all year. So, you know,
well,
get to Sports Cover Arena on that.
If Canterbury, that club? Well,
yep.
If Rowan Walmsley, who played in the Premiership for Canterbury on the weekend, if he's still as good a kick as he was 10 years ago, he could, in actual fact, do it. He's a beautiful left-foot kick, Rowan.
Half-time of the Premier B Grand Final, Sports Cover Arena, that is, that kick for a Volkswagen Golf, which should be entertaining and great to see Bayford getting involved there, providing the car as well. On to Premier C, and you mentioned it in your bad day, Marty. I think I mentioned them the week before, Marcelin. They've lost in straight sets for a third straight year and a seventh loss in a final since they've been down to Premier C. They just can't get out of there, despite being the best side for the past 3 years.
It's almost a bit like this St Kevin story, isn't it? I mean, I'm sure they will, but it's just we need the floodgates to open. Once the floodgates open, they'll be fine. But it must be a mental thing. Surely it must be a mental thing. And look, there's no doubt that the banter that they would be receiving when they run out on the ground from opposition supporters, opposition players, would be around that. It's extraordinary because their home and away form was exemplary.
Yeah, and then towards the end of the year, that resting of players, alleged resting of players, around 18, I think it might have played with their form, tricked their form, and it is a definite mental thing. It stays with you, the banter stays with you, and then the players start second-guessing themselves on the ground, and it's just... Old Halebury, if they kick straight, they could have murdered Marcelin on the weekend.
And
they kicked 9-21.
And the previous week against Old Ivanhoe, they kicked 7 goals, 12 in the last quarter against Old Ivanhoe. So, I mean, they are running into some...
Yeah.
Old Halebury coming like a train. It's amazing. And we probably haven't sung their praises enough over this final series, the Bloods. And they're doing beautiful things in the Premier C finals. We've seen it in a couple of years. Old Ivanhoe actually did this in Premier C two seasons ago. They came through from the bottom rungs of the four to go on and win a famous premiership. And Old Halebury, every chance to do that against Monash Blues on the weekend.
They're playing a ballistic, frenetic style of football, and it's a surprise to me their form against top four sides, as we said during the year, hasn't been great, but their final series has been exemplary.
Blues take looking for their first flag since Division 1 in 2003. Old Halebury looking for their first senior flag, that is, we're talking about, since 2006 when they won an A-section premiership. Who do we like in this game?
It's going to go down to the wire. I'm going to go for Old Halebury. I think their form, the way they're playing, it's just they're running on top of the ground at the moment and they're doing everything right, and I think they can get over Monash.
Oh, no, look, I'm going to go the other side. Which flies in the face of recognising the great form of Halebury. I'm going to go with Monash Blues. I think Paul Graves is coaching them really well. They're organised both on and off field. I think that'll come through with a well-deserved flag.
Yeah. Yep, I'm going to go with Monash Blues as well. On to Division 1 and the grand final result there. We mentioned at the top of the show, congratulations to Q. We wish we had Will Balm here to talk about it and how it all unfolded and how he was selected in the side and played and got his third premiership medallion in a row. First VAFA side to win three in a row since the St Bede's Mentone Tigers, coached by Luke Beveridge for 3 years. I'm not sure if Ian Aitken's got aspirations to coach at AFL level or not, but... nonetheless, St. Bede's Mentone Tigers won three flags and getting three promotions in 3 years from C section to A section 2006 to 2008, and Q will be playing in Premier C next year.
They certainly will be, and with a 6-goal to nil second term that set up the win, and they coasted home to seal it with a 4-goal final term, and back-to-back best on grounds for Kyle Margaritis, the wingman from Q. Not sure. Yeah, Will didn't get close to best on ground. I think he just scrapes in and just he rides on the coattails.
I think he does a lot of pointing.
Yeah, he rides a lot of pointing.
Yeah. Yeah.
But it's a great effort.
We did try to ask him about his form. But
yeah,
we got
he's very cagey about it, isn't he? But I played against Q last year, and they were the best side of Div 2 last year, and they showed it in the final. But it's a great fill-up for them. It's in recruitment and retainment over those 3 years, and it's been fantastic.
But I would also say that as we spoke about last week, it was almost played out.
Yeah.
It was the outside players, the speed of the movement of ball from Q was able to overcome the inside players of Ormond.
That's right.
Old Paradians won their first premiership at a senior level since 1986 when they won a B section under the coaching of Gerard Sholley. They beat Ivanhoe, who were chasing their first senior flag since 1969, so the wait will continue for Ivanhoe. They did manage to pick up the reserves premiership, did Ivanhoe, but Brenton, it would have been a disappointing result if you're a Magpies person coming out of the weekend.
They would have been distraught. The form side all year, they've barely put a foot wrong. Paul Harris had them playing fantastic brand of football, but Dave Bandy and his crew, Jimmy Kandalakis, just got him in a dogfight. They turned into a scrap, and it was they got him by 15 points in the end with a come-from-behind win, and a win that I didn't see coming. Boys, I was wrong. I didn't pick you, but congratulations.
Great result for Old Paradians, and as we mentioned, that hopefully they're turning things around. Congratulations to David Boundy, who captain coached them. I don't know if he's captain, he's a playing coach, that's for sure.
Playing coach, yeah.
But it's a really good effort for him, and reward for Old Paradians, but also a reward for Ivanhoe too, to come up.
Yeah.
I think that's, again, we need to temper that by saying they are coming up. It's a bit like Ormond, they are coming up a grade. They're going up a grade. Now they just need to reboost and recharge the batteries in a way.
I reckon they just had an off day, and as you said, they're a club on the rise. And their Colts, unfortunately, had an off day as well against Uni High. Uni High got the Colts.
Absolutely did, and I think their Colts were favourites going into
that
game.
Yeah, they would have been,
So a mixed day overall for them. But
I don't think we got mixed day amongst the good and bad days. We never developed a mixed day situation.
We didn't have grey area, we just had black or white.
We didn't have fence sitting. We could have called it a splintered day, sitting on the fence. But we don't do that here on the Tragics.
I think it's time for me to go.
We mentioned West Brunswick at the top of the show. Great result for them beating Emmaus St. Leo's by a point. And commiserations to Emmaus St. Leo's. Superb effort to go throughout the whole season. It unfortunately dropped their final game of the year by a point. It doesn't come much more heartbreaking than that.
No, they get the Div 3 medalist in Paul Baronello, and they're going through as a champion team, unfortunately. Just couldn't get done on the big day. But as you said, West Brunswick, fantastic. They know how to win grand finals.
Successive years.
Yeah, in successive years. And we might have sold them a little bit short. Willie B didn't pick it, unfortunately. So that may have really irks me that he got something right. But we won't be hearing the end of that. But congratulations to West Brunswick, and they're heading to Div 2 next year.
Canterbury won their first VAFA flag in their second season in the competition, beating an old VAFA side in Parkside. It was a great effort from Parkside to come from sixth place, and I think this sells the final six as a success story. We've seen it twice now from Division 4 where the sixth place side has come through. Parkside couldn't quite win the flag like Northern Blues did. However, what about the idea? The debate around the final six has been there. Perhaps we give the bye to the top two sides and let the have two elimination finals, three playing six and four playing five, top two go through, and that might appease some of the people that are concerned about the final six.
I think that would work. I think that's definitely something the VAFA should look at for next year. But I agree, the final six is a success, and they should implement it for sure next year and try and move it up maybe a couple of grades as well.
You'd like to see it in a 10-team comp? Surely
not. No, not in a 10-team comp, no. Maybe trying to recruit a few more sides. And
Marty, do you like that idea of giving the top two a bye?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. Then they can go and watch their prospective opponent beat the absolute suitcase out of each other. And, I mean, that's why. I mean, you're rewarding consistency, aren't you? You're rewarding those players and those clubs who've done all the right things. Then you're not in that position where you're resting or allegedly resting players in round 18 to preserve them. They're going to be rewarded.
That's right.
That's the week off. Freshen up, feel better about yourself, go and watch the opposition, your prospective opposition, as a group, then come back out and away we go.
It just throws up surprise results as well, as we saw. First, second and third got done in the first week of the finals.
Absolutely. No.
So I just wanted to say congratulations also to Rowan Wormsley, an old DLR player at Canterbury. I just saw on their Facebook page, won his fifth BNF as well as being a premiership player. So well done to
fantastic result. The other congratulations to the junior premiers in Old Zavarians in under 19, MEG under 19 premier, Caulfield Grammarians in under 19 section 2, Old Kerry in under 19 section 3, St Kevin's in under 19 section 4, and you mentioned Brenton before, UHSVU Flemington won the VAFA Colts competition. There's no predictions this week, but we do have Marty Kelleher's final wine of the week.
This week's wine of the week is actually a Tobilk Viognier. So Viognier is what we call an aromatic wine. So for those people who are looking to toast the sweet smell of success, not only will you be able to do that with this wine, lovely with lightly spiced dishes or Asian dishes, terrific wine as we move into summer. So Viognier, please contact me. You can find out my details through Blair down here at headquarters, and we'll move on. Now, what is the actual wine?
Final one of the year, Marty. Make it good.
It's got to be good. Don't sit on the fence.
Don't sit on the fence. What am I doing next Monday night?
Well, what are we doing next Monday night?
What are we doing next Monday night?
I don't know.
I haven't
actually thought about what we're going to be doing next Monday night.
Maybe we could
have to hang out. I have to hang out with my family at home.
Can't be done. No. Can't be done. But look, while we're at it, guys, let's toast.
We'll taste. Cheers.
Taste.
Beautiful to Tobilk. Been doing beautifully this year.
It's a Jimmy Halliday wine of the week. It's sparkling of the week.
Great so year of tragedy.
Thank you very much. Thank you, everyone.
And what is your wine of the week? What you got one? No more footy.
What am I going to do?
Enjoy the Spring Carnival. Sure,
that's absolute wine season, the Spring Carnival, isn't it?
Sure.
It is. Boy, I'm going to be busy the next few weeks.
Has the Bill got a couple of marquees that you'll be able to sneak into?
No, we don't.
In all seriousness, though, Marty, thank you very much for your contribution this year over the full season of Vaffa Tragics. It was great to have you on. Sorry we couldn't get D-Lar over the line for you throughout the finals.
It's been terrific though, hasn't it?
It's been good.
Thank you, Andrew.
Brenton, thank you. I think you're the only consistent. You fronted up every week?
Marty?
Yeah, no. No, I actually had it. I allegedly rested 1 week.
I think you and I were
I think we made it through all the way, so thank you very much.
We're the stalwarts.
Thank you also to Will, who's in the background doing everything and our cameras behind the scenes. And thank you to everyone that's been watching the show over the course of the season. Of course, without you guys watching, we don't have a show. We're all Vaffa Tragics at heart, and hopefully we're all back next year to watch another fantastic season of the VAFA. Enjoy the grand finals on the weekend if you're going. Hope you're enjoying the success if your team's already played. We'll see you again in 2016. Vaffa TV at vafatv.com.